Good evening. We want to welcome you as we gather this evening for this Good Friday service, and as we remember what Jesus did. You know, we think about God and his love, but we also need to remember that God is also holy. And what took place on what we've come known as Good Friday is how the love of God found a way to meet the holiness of God and satisfy it to bring us back into relationship with him. And so we want to take a moment this evening to remember that. And we're glad that you can tune in and join us this evening. It's going to be a simple service with some prayer and music and a message. And we're going to also have the opportunity to share in communion together virtually as we do this over line, so that hopefully we can feel connected as a community even in the midst of our social distancing. So let's bow for a word of prayer and we'll get started. A glorious and loving Father, we come before you and we marvel at your love and your goodness that would send your Son to die upon a cross in order to bring us back into a relationship with yourself. Your word tells us that it was while we were sinners and enemies that you sent your Son to die on our behalf. And we can't even begin to imagine the love that you have for us, nor just the seriousness of the consequences of our sin. That would separate us from you and the extent that you would go to bring us back into relationship with yourself. Lord, we thank you for all that you've done, and we pray that as we join together tonight, that we would be able to remember the sacrifice that has been made and all that's been achieved through that sacrifice, that we might live in relationship with you. We invite you to come and to anoint this time, to give a sense of your presence to all those who are tuning in, that even though we may be physically separated, that there would be a sense of spiritual unity as the body of Christ as we celebrate you and all that you've done through your Son, Jesus Christ. It is in his name that we come. Amen. I think up on the screen we're going to put a call to worship that we could kind of do a responsive call to worship as we start here tonight. So I will do the leader portion, and then the bold, you'll see where you can join in at home. Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why so disturbed within me? Jesus bore our sins in his body on the cross. Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. For he died that we might die to sin and live to righteousness.
Join us as we sing Man of Sorrows.
Of God, by his
Will you join with me in the prayer of confession? It should be up on your screen. O holy God, it was not for Jesus' crimes that he died upon the cross, but for mine. He took my sin, my shame, my guilt, my cross, in order that I might be able to come before you. He never misspoke, yet I have often sinned both in words said and unsaid. His attitudes were pure, yet mine often reflect selfishness and sin. His deeds were righteous, yet I have often failed both in what I've done and left undone. Forgive me, I pray, not based on what I have done or deserve, but by the cross that he bore for me. For I was there when they crucified my Lord. I was there when they nailed him to the tree. I was there when they laid him in the tomb, and that he did it all for me. Amen.
We continue on with Scandal of Grace.
Follow God. Oop. Good evening. We'll be reading from Isaiah 52, verse 13, through Isaiah 53, verse 12. See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and greatly exalted. Just as many were appalled at you, his appearance was so disfigured they did not look like a man, and his form did not resemble a human being. So he will sprinkle many nations. Kings will shut their mouths because of him, for they will see what he had been told them, and they will understand what they had not heard. Who has believed? What we have heard? What have we heard? Who has the arm of the Lord been revealed to? He grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of a dry ground. He had no form or splendor that we should look at him, no appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of suffering who knew what sickness was. He was like one people turned away from. He was despised, and we did not value him. Yet he himself bore our sickness. He carried our pains, and we in turn regarded him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was pierced because of our transgressions, crushed because of our iniquities. Punishment for our peace was on him, and we are healed by his wounds. We all went away astray like sheep. We all have turned to our own way, and the Lord has punished him for the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, and like a sheep silent before her shears, he did not open his mouth. He was taken away because of the oppression and judgment, and who considered his fate? For he was cut off from the land of the living. He was struck because of my people's rebellion. They made his grave with wicked and with rich and at his death. Although he had done no violence and had not spoken deceitfully, yet the Lord was pleased to crush him, and he made him sick. When you make him a restitution offering, he will see his seed, he will prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will succeed by his hand. He will see it out of his anguish, and he will be satisfied with his knowledge. My righteous servant will justify many, and he will carry their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him the many as a portion, and he will receive the mighty as a spoil, because he submitted himself to death and was counted among the rebels. Yet he bore the sin of many and interceded for the rebels. I ask your blessing upon Dan's message, and especially the scripture.
There are remarkable figures throughout history who have played pivotal roles in shaping history, both for good and for bad. And I could go through and I can mention names such as St. Augustine or Martin Luther. We can throw out people like John Calvin, John Wesley, Alexander Campbell, Barton Stone, maybe some names that you're familiar with. Of course, there are conquerors like Alexander the Great, Napoleon. There's dreamers like Martin Luther King. We can look at religious figures throughout history like Muhammad and Billy Graham, or villains like Hitler. We can look at scientists such as Isaac Newton and Albert Einstein. We could even name some politicians. We're just going to stick with Abraham Lincoln because we don't want to get any fights over politics, right? But we can look at different figures throughout history who have made a significant impact on the world and upon how history shaped. We can mention people like Dan Jasmine. Okay, I'm just trying to see if you guys are paying attention or not. It's a little bit easier when there's an audience to get a response from, but I'm checking in, right? Of course, in times like the present, we're also reminded that there are many unsung heroes, such as our first responders and healthcare workers. You know, not everybody who's remarkable in history gets their name written down. In fact, many of us can probably look at significant people in our own lives that could have been life-changing, and yet their names won't go down in the annals of history. But who knows? In another 100 years, your name might just be on that list. But there can be no doubt that topping that list of remarkable figures who has made the greatest impact of all time would be none other than Jesus Christ. And when you think about Jesus, his life was marked by powerful teaching and miracles and healings, raising the dead, feeding the multitudes, compassion and grace and forgiveness. And, you know, perhaps some small things as well, such as tempted in every way, yet without sin. Try that for your next New Year's resolution. Or maybe try that for your next shelter at home experience. I don't know about the rest of you, but this is very taxing in many ways upon us. You know, the influence that Jesus has made in the world is really beyond measure. In fact, I've got an excellent book at home. It's called Unimaginable by Jeremiah Johnson. And part of what he writes about is the influence that Jesus and his followers have made on the world and how you could identify cultures that have been touched by his teachings in very significant ways. And in fact, one of the points he makes in the book, you know, any number of people are being treated for COVID-19. Well, most of those hospitals were probably started by Christians, as they've made such a remarkable influence upon the world and following Christ. Nobody's teaching has had a greater impact, and yet his life, his ministry, and his teaching, there is no one else who is noted as much for the significance of their death. This is what's really remarkable about Jesus. For all the wonder, all the splendor, all the majesty of his life, there's nobody who's made such a significant impact through their death. You know, even in the darkest hours of history, when the Lord of glory was being crucified, when God's presence was anything but felt, when God's hand was anything but visible, God was performing the greatest work of all time. He was performing the work that it would take to reunite a sinful person to him in his eternal glory. You know, sometimes we need hindsight to truly be able to see. That is, unless we benefit from understanding the foresight of what God revealed through the prophets. It's interesting that in the ministry of Jesus, one of the things that he taught over and over again, or several times, was, I must suffer and die. I must suffer and die. It was for this purpose that I came, to give my life a ransom. So what was that all about? You know, this passage from Isaiah is a remarkable passage of Scripture. It was written more than 700 years prior to Christ. Its message forecasts Jesus' death, it predicts his resurrection, and it enlightens us to the significance of these events. And the key to this passage is the identity of my servant. See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted, 52:13. And we'll see how so much in this chapter points forward to and is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. But what we see in this chapter, or in these chapters, is that salvation would be the work of God's servant. And it says that he will act wisely. For those of you who tuned in last Sunday, we did a sermon on embracing wisdom and how Jesus is the wisdom of God. So it ties in really nicely with last Sunday's sermon. I love it when things like that happen. But he says he will act wisely, be raised up, lifted up, and highly exalted. You know, that's kind of the language that we enjoy and we love. That's kind of what we want to hear as Christians. We want to hear about him being raised up and lifted and highly exalted. We want everything to be victory and glory. But seldom do we consider the cost behind making the victory possible. You know, too often we want to jump to the end and we want to shortcut the process. As I was thinking about this, many of us have joked around about, if you want patience, don't pray for it, right? Because God will give you what it takes to learn patience. But for most of us, we're like, Lord, just make me patient. But don't give me the circumstances to learn patience. We want to shortcut the process. As I was thinking about this, I thought, where are you going to learn patience better than sheltering at home? You know, I mean, isn't this really one of the things that's teaching us a lot about ourselves when our routines are disrupted? When our comfort zones are disrupted, when everything that we've grown to know and love, it's kind of come to a halt, right? It's a wonderful time to learn patience. We like to ask God to make us holy, but we don't want those fires that refine. We want to shortcut the process. We desire the Easter celebration, but we would rather bypass the pain of the crucifixion. But it's the crucifixion that reminds us that God is at work, even when we cannot see him. Even through the darkest of times, God is still fulfilling his purposes. And so we get this beginning in verse 13 of how he will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted. We can't wait to get to the Easter resurrection. But what we want to focus on this evening is the path that preceded that destination. And so we go into verse 14. Just as there were many who were appalled at him, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any man, and his form marred beyond human likeness. So will he sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For what they were not told, they will see, and what they have not heard, they will understand. They will be appalled at him. He will be disfigured. He'll be marred beyond human likeness. Now, we kind of come to this verse, and we want to be like, just wait a minute. Can't we just go back to raised and lifted up and acting wisely and highly exalted? Now, if you have seen the movie The Passion of the Christ, then you kind of have a picture and an understanding of what it's talking about when it says he will be beaten and disfigured and marred beyond likeness. It's a very gruesome and heart-wrenching picture to see. But you kind of get a glimpse of what this verse is talking about. A.W. Tozer wrote that we understand and acknowledge that the resurrection has placed a glorious crown upon all of Christ's sufferings. But I want you to take note that that road included his sufferings and his death. We can't get to the destination before we travel the path that took him there. And that's kind of what we do on this Friday as we gather to remember the crucifixion, as we take a look at the path that preceded the resurrection and this Easter celebration. We come to verse 15, and it says, so will he sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For what they were not told, they will see, and what they have not heard, they will understand. So we have this picture that he's going to be appalled. They're going to be appalled at him. He's going to be disfigured. He's going to be marred beyond human likeness. This is all leading up to his death. And then we get this language, for he will sprinkle. It's kind of a weird language for us to read. But this is the same word that's used in the book of Leviticus for sprinkling the sacrificial blood for atonement. And what we're seeing in these pictures, and this fits with our Core 52 topic for this week, for those of you who are doing Core 52 with us, is this picture of his death functioning as an atonement for the nations. Just as in Leviticus, we have the sacrificial system where you have all these animal sacrifices and the sprinkling of blood to make atonement, to give a covering for sin. That's the same language that's being used here for the death of Jesus. He will sprinkle many nations. Now, a basic Bible dictionary will tell you that atonement, since that's a word that may be foreign to some of you, that it's the process by which two parties, typically estranged, are made at one. So if you think about the word atonement, it's about making two at one. It's about reconciling them together. And it's the means of reconciliation between God and people. And so when you think about why we have this Friday, why we celebrate this crucifixion, it's because what we needed was not another wise teacher. What we needed was not another fearless leader. What we needed was not another moral role model. But Jesus was all of these things, but what we needed was something that nobody else in all of history could give. And that was a Savior. Somebody who could cover us for our sin, bring us forgiveness, and give us atonement that we might be at one with God once again. The verse goes on to say, kings will shut their mouths. Basically, it's simply saying that the kings will be astonished. They'll be left speechless. For what they were not told, they will see, and what they have not heard, they will understand. This is the marvel of what will take place, is the one who was appalled at and disfigured and marred will be the one that will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted, and people will be left speechless of what God has done through the death and resurrection of Jesus. The reason why I point that out is these few verses in chapter 52, verses 13 through 15, they almost kind of give us a heading and an introduction into the chapter that we want to explore tonight, Isaiah 53. In Isaiah 53, we see the necessity of the cross to provide this atonement, to make us one at one with God. And these verses are like a prologue to Jesus that was written over 700 years prior to the Gospels. Now, if we fast forward to the Gospel of John, John tells us, Jesus came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. In Isaiah 53, verses 2 and 3, says he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. He grew up like a tender shoot. Oswald describes the shoot as the normally unwanted shoot that springs up from an exposed root. You know, at the side of our porch, we have a little tree, and at the bottom of that tree, we have all these little shoots that are coming up. I have to knock them out with the weed eater or trim them with some trimmers because they're not supposed to be there. They just grow out and they get in the way. That's the language that's being used here to speak of Jesus. He'll be like this unwanted shoot that comes up from an exposed root. It says there's no beauty or majesty to attract us. You think about the Jews and what they were expecting in the Messiah. They wanted a royal, regal figure. They didn't want a peasant carpenter from Nazareth. He was ordinary. He was plain. He was not the type of Messiah that they were looking for. And as we know, as the events of this Holy Week unfold, it wasn't simply that they weren't attracted to him. He was despised, and he was rejected. And it comes down to says, we esteemed him not. Simply means we failed to recognize him for who he was. In fact, we get in the New Testament, and how often do we hear Peter or Paul saying, you rejected him and crucified the Lord of glory because you did not know. You did not recognize who he was. Verses 4 to 6 is going to continue. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. It was kind of interesting because Isaiah is writing prophetically of what is to come, but he's also writing reflectively as one looking back on something that he now has understanding of. At the same time that he was not... He had no beauty or majesty to attract us, and that he was being despised and rejected. He understands that he was taking upon himself our infirmities, our sorrows, our afflictions, our transgressions, our iniquities, that we were like sheep going astray, but the iniquity of us all was being laid upon him. You know, we've kind of developed this false notion of the innate goodness of people. Mitch Glaser writes, based upon the evidence of history, it would take more faith to believe in man's innate goodness than to believe what the Bible says about man's fall. It's interesting. So often we look at somebody and we think, well, they're a good person, and they're a good person, and we base it on nothing more than maybe they seem better than most, or they have some goodness or some love or some kindness about them. And we have this idea in our hearts, well, surely they're in heaven because they're a good person. And we fail to understand that we don't really have this innate goodness. In fact, when we think about COVID-19 and all the crisis that we're in, you know, it brings out the best in some people. And we see first responders, and we see people putting their lives on the line, and we see people doing everything they can to help others out. But at the same time, we also see multitudes of people taking advantage. We see people scamming. We see all sorts of bickering and fighting and hatred and contempt. Just watch the news media and watch the politicians go at one another. We see all this that indicates to us about the sinfulness of people and the selfishness of people. Glaser goes on to write, he says, when sin is measured by standards that we establish rather than by standards that God established, we will always come out looking less sinful. However, I think we all know deep in our souls that we most often do not even meet our own standards for righteousness, much less God's. You know, when I think about my own life, I can't tell you how many times I do things and I think, that's not the person I want to be. That doesn't even meet my own standard of righteousness. How much less does it meet the standard of God's righteousness? How much less does it meet his standard? And the irony of it all is here in the text, when when he was rejected and despised, and when he was being crucified, in the eyes of people, it was like he was being punished by God. And the irony that Isaiah is telling us is that it was actually our punishment that he was taking. For all the ways that we had fallen short of the righteousness of God. Verses 7 and 8 are going to continue. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And who can speak of his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. He did not open his mouth. I don't know about the rest of you, but when I'm suffering unjustly, my tendency is to open my mouth. My tendency is to defend myself, to rationalize, to come out on top. Now, for that matter, even if I'm accused rightly, even when I'm accused rightly, my first tendency is to defend myself, to rationalize and to justify. When it says that he did not open his mouth, he's basically saying, even though he would have rightly been able to defend himself, he willingly lays down his life. He willingly lays down his life, just as John 10 tells us, I lay down my life of my own accord. When he comes down and speaks of the oppressive judgment, it's basically speaking of the corrupt trial, the oppressive judgment of others, the corrupt trial that he's going to go through. Verse 9 then continues, he was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And we have a little juxtaposition that takes place here, because you remember Jesus was crucified between two thieves. He was numbered with the transgressors, but then he was buried in a rich man's tomb. One of the comments that Mark Moore made in his book, Core 52, as he said, it was kind of as if God let Jesus do all of these things to take our sins upon himself, but then he said, no more. I draw the line. And he afforded him a proper burial at that point. But the verse goes on then to reiterate that all of this took place despite his innocence. He had done no violence, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. He was the innocent sufferer. And sometimes we kind of scratch our heads and we wonder, why would God allow this to happen? Verse 10 continues. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him. It was the Lord's will to crush him and to cause him to suffer. You know, that's a line that just makes you pause for a moment, isn't it? We love to talk about the love of God, that it was the Lord's will to crush him. You know, that's language that we don't normally think about because we don't think about how serious sin was and what God had to do in order to make atonement for our sin, that we might be forgiven and reconciled and brought to him. So verse 10 goes on and it gives us the answer where it says, and though the Lord makes his life as a guilt offering. This is what Mark Moore is talking about in his book, Core 52. If you're following with us this year, we're kind of going through that as our theme. And this week's chapter is on atonement, this idea of covering for sin, of something that takes place as a sacrifice to make us at one with God. And what Isaiah is telling us is that Jesus was the sacrifice. That's the picture of him taking our sin upon himself. Fleming Rutledge writes, how do we measure the size of a fire? By the number of firefighters and fire engines sent to fight against it. How do we measure the seriousness of a medical condition? By the amount of risk the doctors take in prescribing dangerous antibiotics or surgical procedures. How do we measure the gravity of sin and the incomparable vastness of God's love for us? Think about this for a moment. How do we measure the gravity of sin and the incomparable vastness of God's love for us? We measure it by the magnitude of what God has done for us in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who became like a common criminal for our sake and who died in our place. That's how we recognize the vastness of the gravity of sin and of God's love for us. You know, the penalty or wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23 tells us. So nothing less than death would pay the penalty. A holy God, in his love, chose not to socially distance himself from a diseased people in order that he might provide the cure and the vaccine to a disease that's far more rampant and far more deadly than COVID-19. You know, sin infects all of us, and its death rate is 100%. But God has given us life through his Son, Jesus Christ. So that gets us to this place of the raised and lifted up and highly exalted. If you look at the rest of the result, verse 10 continues after the guilt offering. It's interesting. He just was made a guilt offering, and then it goes on, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong. Because he poured out his life unto death, and was numbered with the transgressors, for he bore the sin of many, and made the intercession for the transgressors. His rejection was transformed. It goes and says he will see his offspring. It's basically talking about all the believers who will follow him after his resurrection. He will see his offspring, prolong his days. He will prosper in his hand. Verse 11, when it says he will see the light of life, it's a glimpse of his resurrection that he will experience. And then it comes into this nice little language, and he will be satisfied. He will be satisfied. You ever done something and achieved something, and you're set back, and you were just kind of satisfied in what you had accomplished? Think about what makes enduring all the suffering, all the pain, and all the death worthwhile. You know, it's when the joy of what is achieved exceeds the cost of achieving it. In fact, in Hebrews, it tells us there was the joy set before him that he endured the cross. This is how meaningful you are to him. This is how greatly he loves you, that he would be willing to go to the cross on your behalf to deal with the gravity of sin, but also to show you the love of God. The verse goes on to talk about by his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many. You might understand that a little bit better if you think of it in this way. Through knowledge of him, many will be justified. That word justified means just as if I'd never sinned. It's the idea of being declared innocent. It's a legal term. Being declared innocent in court. This is where you get the New Testament articulation of the justification by faith. It's rooted right here in Isaiah 53. As he tells us, the purpose for which he had to die was to make atonement for our sins, that we might be justified before a holy God. His portion is those who believe. Now, if you remember, we started with John 1:11, where it talked about him being rejected. I want to read for you John 1:11 and verse 12, where it says, he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Then verse 12 continues. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Those who were formerly estranged, as Romans would call us, sinners and enemies, they're now at one with God through his sacrifice. Paul kind of gives us a one-sentence commentary in 2 Corinthians 5:21. Some of you are thinking, one sentence commentary, we should have just started right there. He says, he made him who knew no sin to become sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. You know, in the darkness of what became known as Good Friday, we should be reminded that even when things seemed darkest, God was at work in ways that we could not see to achieve purposes beyond our imagination. And within the short passage that was written over 700 years before Jesus, F.B. Meyer points out 10 prophecies that were fulfilled in Jesus. Jesus suffered an appalling, disfiguring death, 52:14. His blood sprinkled the nations and brought kings to submission, 52:15. Jesus was rejected by Israel for being too plain, chapter 53:1-3. His suffering was considered to be punishment for his sin by Israel, verse 4. He suffered and died without resistance, accepting God's will to provide atonement for Israel and for the world, verses 4 through 8. He was buried in a rich man's tomb, verse 9. He was resurrected from the dead, verses 10 and 11. He was given innumerable followers, that's the offspring or spiritual seed of verse 10. He is satisfied today with the forgiveness that his death provided, verse 11. And he's been rewarded by God the Father as the victor over sin, verse 12. One that Meyer did not point out is this one right here as well, that he would be numbered with the transgressors as he died between two thieves. You know, we may not in the moment see God's hand or feel God's presence, but that doesn't mean that God isn't at work in our midst. In fact, some of the darkest moments, moments such as the crucifixion, provide the opportunity for God to reveal to us his wonderful love and the extent that he has gone through to bring us back into a relationship with himself. So let's join together as we remember this wondrous love that he has given to us through Christ.
What?
You know, while the Romans crucified thousands upon thousands, there's only one that we pause to remember. And it's because his death had such profound significance that it truly changed the world. And it was through his death that we were reconciled, that we are reconciled to God. And so we remember that on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And when he'd given thanks, he broke it and he said, "This is my body which is for you, to bear your infirmities, to carry your sorrows, to take your afflictions and your transgressions, your iniquities and your punishment." He said, "Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, sprinkled as an atonement for your sins, a guilt offering made on your behalf. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Let us pray. Oh, gracious God, as we pause for this moment, and as we commune together around this table, and as we recall how Jesus has taken our sins, our transgressions, our iniquities, how they've all been laid upon him, how through his punishment we find peace and that we're made healed. We just pray that there would be some that are listening here tonight that can finally be at peace, that they can know that the sins that they've committed, that they weren't right, but that they've been covered, and that you've restored us into a relationship with yourself, that there's nothing that we have done that hasn't been covered by his blood if we just turn to you and receive the atonement that's been made for us in Jesus' name. Help us to receive the forgiveness that's been offered as we come to you through faith in him. Amen. We invite you to participate as you're ready with your communion at home, as we partake, and then as we close in song and prayer.
Jesus, God's own Son, precious Lamb of God.
as we think of the extraordinary events that took place, as we remember how he was disfigured and marred and crucified, it reveals to us both the gravity of sin, but also the vastness of God's love for you. I pray that as you rest tonight, as you reflect on the events of this day, that you know how greatly the Father loves you, and that you know that whatever you have done in your past, that his forgiveness is sufficient, his grace is more than adequate, and that he has covered that sin through faith in Jesus Christ. So be at peace in him. Amen.
Would you please join us as we close with What a Savior.